HA the way these two have. And this weekend, there is more on the line than just pride. Much more. First place is at stake, and both schools want it bad. We'll tell you all about it next on the Doug Loeb Show. For this week's Doug Loeb Show, as preparations are being made for this weekend series against the Wisconsin Badgers. Find yourself in third place, but only a point out of first. Boy, what a tight race. Nice race this year.
Well, it's nice for CC and Wisconsin right now. They're tied for first, and we're at 35 points. We have 34. It's a tight one, and you know, we've got some big games coming up, too. We've got Minnesota playing Wisconsin, which is always the biggest series of the year. Then we got St. Cloud, which is, I'm sure, one of the top ones for them, as well as for us coming up next weekend. So we're in a dogfight right now, but I don't think it's ever been a more exciting race than it is right now, Frank.
Those two schools that you mentioned, Wisconsin and St. Cloud State, that would give the Gophers the toughest schedule among the top five contenders, and really you almost have to make it six now with Alaska Anchorage.
Yeah, well, Anchorage is in a contention for a playoff spot, and they're not in contention really for first place, but they're in contention for the other. And you got Northern Michigan with 31 points, or St. Cloud with 30. So everybody's in the race, and I don't think you'll know till the final whistle blows on Saturday night, 2 weeks from now, exactly who's going to be where.
So how do you like this tougher schedule?
Well, it's a great pre-postseason schedule. In other words, you're going to get ready by high tempo games with lots of crowds, lots of importance on it, and lots of pressure on the game. So that part of it's good. And you know, it's nice to be in the hunt. I'd rather be us than the ones that are in the bottom half.
Sure.
We have something to gain by going into Wisconsin. We have something to gain by beating St. Cloud. So the importance of the games adds the enthusiasm in the competitive spirit of the hockey contest.
You've got a couple things, I think, to look at in terms of preparation for this series. One is how well you played against Wisconsin when you swept them here back in the middle of the season. And also, you have to look at how this team has been playing recently. Both, I imagine, could be factors in getting them motivated, because it's been a little bit of a struggle now.
If we go to one, we started playing really well about the time we beat Wisconsin. In fact, that was kind of a springboard for us. We pole vaulted from there. We catapulted from there. I believe right now we haven't played as well the last 2 weeks for whatever reasons. I think composite, when we were in our unbelievable run there, we were playing so hard and so competitively. We were just trying to win games, and we weren't worrying about points, and that's what we have to go back to, is just to try to win the games, play competitively, and then take what happens.
Mentally, how do you feel the guys are after the double-dip loss to Anchorage over the weekend?
Well, we're talking about having fewer toes. You know, they say you shoot your foot off, but we didn't shoot our foot off. We just pushed off a few toes. But, you know, that's the life of this deal. There was 12 points to be had by teams at top at home, and only one was taken. That was St. Cloud against Colorado College. So there's some other people that faltered too. But we got to get it back and get it going today.
Okay, and perhaps no easier way to get yourself motivated than to play against the Wisconsin Badgers. We will rewind the tape a little bit and take a look back at last weekend and the two losses on home ice to Alaska Anchorage right after this timeout.
MVP for hockey parents this season.
Back at last weekend's series against the Seawolves from Alaska Anchorage, a team that the coaches picked to finish 10th in the league this year. But you told us right here on this show that there was going to be a better team than that. Now, were you hedging a little bit? And, you know, you have lost to them three times.
No, I think we're just saying that because they're new in the league doesn't mean they're new at the game. And we felt, having played them a number of times over the last half dozen years, that they had, they had good players. They had a lot of enthusiasm. Their program was solid. They draw 6,400. They sell out. And they have a real good base there. And I think the fact that they are able to win as many games lately on the road as they have is really a tribute to them, but it does say that they got a good program.
Play real solid, steady. They look to be very consistent over the whole weekend.
Yeah, they were, and they were tough. And, you know, when you get the goaltender playing like that, you get the confidence.
All right, both teams, I think, were a little bit sluggish in the opener Friday night, even though you had to come back to tie the score at 1-1.
Yeah, we were. Sluggish has probably been pretty nice. finally, Bianchi gets a goal here. Andy Brink comes in from the wide side, and looks like he's really getting some penetration and gets the puck to the front. And somehow or another goes off. I can't tell if it goes off Bianchi's stick or exactly what happens. But, you know, we get the tire, and we're back in the game.
A couple of long goals will give them the lead. This one by Leggett makes it 2-1.
I believe that's right after the faceoff. We tie it, and we're all excited, and then, boom, right off the faceoff, the guy blows by our winger at the faceoff, goes in the zone and throws it back out, and it's a fairly long shot by Leggett, and it's 2-1, and you know, our ecstasy lasted about 8 seconds, and we're back in trouble again.
Still in the second period, the Seawolves go by up by a count by 3-1. Cotton Gore gets it.
Yeah, he's got a brother named Forrest Gore, too. Forrest to Cotton Gore, can you imagine that in the next year? Makes it 3-1, and then now we got a bigger hill to climb.
All right, so now to the third period, you start to get back in it with pull within one on a Charlie Wosley goal.
I think this was with about 5 or 6 minutes left. We got Peebelkorn up the right side. He hits Danny Wu. He pulls up short at the blue line. Bobby Dustin comes in, and then Wosley joins him late, which is, you know, maybe our nicest play of the night. He comes in and shoots it in the left-hand side.
A lot of times what you like to do in a game where you're struggling is win the third period. You won this one. Wound up out shooting him by a pretty good margin, 43-20 for the game. Did you feel like you had a good jump? Was that a good springboard to go into Saturday night's game?
Well, yeah, we had two games. We had 28 minutes of gosh-awful stuff, and then we had 32 minutes of pretty good hockey, but we just couldn't score enough. And you know, when you start out and give the other team 28 minutes without you playing, you might be in a bigger hole than we were, and we just couldn't dig out. But I thought coming back the next day we would play harder, and as you see right off the bat, the first period, there are lots of good goals. Lots of nice highlights to look at here, and we were ready to play.
And Jeff Nielsen is getting to be a bit of a routine, scores the Gophers' first goal of the game.
Yeah, Jeff gets a pass from Bianchi, I believe, on this one, coming from the corner all the way across in front, and he tips it in, and he gets another, like, one of his 12 or 13 first goals of the game this year for Jeff.
That makes the score 1-1. Nielsen will come back and on the power play, and this goal ties it at 2.
Now, this is a big one-timer. I mean, you talk about big-timer, this is a big one-timer from the high, high slot. He just rips it, and, you know, it makes us happy again.
And the team's other leading goal scorer, Brian Bonin, puts the Gophers up by a count, 3-2. This also on the power play.
Yeah, one-timer again. We needed some help on that side because we were getting lots of our power play was off to our left side, to the right side of the rink, and we moved the puck from the Galpine. Nice little push pass over to Bonin, and he cranks it and shows lots of enthusiasm.
Okay, on to the second period, and it turns out to be a Seawolf period, and they get all three goals here.
Yeah, we made a lot of one-player errors, Frank. You know, either we didn't make a save, or we turned the puck over, or we didn't pick somebody up, and it was a one-shot and in. And, you know, we hadn't been doing that. And you know, as you look at the goals that are scored, when you have breakdowns individually, you're going to have some problems.
Are those mistakes hard to take for a coach, or how difficult are they to handle?
Well, you get two kinds, one that are mental and one that are physical. In the physical, we're human, and you can expect that. I guess well, you're human mentally, too, but it's not quite as easily when you know, you got to lay your heart on. You just got to be right there on the whole thing. And I think sometimes if you just take an inch off, it's enough. And our team is fragile enough that little inch or that differentiation is really the reason we didn't win over the weekend.
Okay, let's go back and take a look at the final goal scored in that one. This one by Dan Woog to make it a 5-4 contest.
Well, this was a delayed penalty, and I don't know why Dan, center of the next line, is supposed to go over. He went and he joined the crowd just as a, you know, and the puck got there about the time he was getting to the offensive zone, and he popped in the rebound. And, you know, to credit to him, he's going to the net, and somebody made a good play there. So then we thought we had a chance again. The crowd was really into it, and the opening faceoff, boom. We make an errant pass, and then they shoot it in from about 50 feet. And that's, you know, if I think back to a series where we scored a key goal in each game, and then 10 seconds later, it was back in our net. You know, on Friday night, it was the same thing on their second goal. And this one here, it was, you know, it was 5-4. We had a chance to really get back in it. 10 seconds later, it's in our net again.
Yeah, I don't think that's happened all except this last weekend.
And that's the way you went on the road. You shut down the other people's enthusiasm. And everybody's excited. You score, and now the whole thing kind of sags.
Okay, the coach, you have heard quite a bit from him during the course of the year. We're going to let Dan Wu do the talking in just a moment or two. Plus, we'll hear from Coach Dean Williamson right after this timeout on the Doug Wu Show. continues on Midwest Sports Channel, and once again, it's time to take a look back at some of the men who used to wear the M here at the University of Minnesota. And I think none other is any larger in folks' hearts than Dean Williamson. And right now, Field of Dreams is proud to bring you Dean Williamson. He's standing by with the publisher of Let's Play Hockey, Doug Johnson.
Thanks, Frank. And Dino, you look at your Gopher career, 1986 to 1990, and a couple of WCHA championships and the playoffs every year. But I look at it on paper, 1989, when you lost to Harvard in overtime at the St. Paul Civic Center in the finals. That had to be your highlight.
Oh, no question. That was it was a thrill of a lifetime, and we came up short of goal, obviously, but it was definitely a thrill of a lifetime to be able to attend the NCAA. Not only that, but have it in St. Paul, Minnesota. The fan support and playing together with a group of guys, a wonderful group of guys, was a tremendous experience. One I'll never forget, and I'll cherish that all the time.
Tell us your thoughts before the game and then after that game.
Well, before the game, the funny thing is we played Maine night before, Friday night, and it was about impossible. I remember I was rooming with Grant Bischoff at the time, and we got to sleep about 6 o'clock. You know, we were in bed by 10:30, but just thoughts going through your mind. You're playing the national championship. It's here. And just excitement. You could not get to sleep. And finally got to sleep at about 6 in the morning. You know, woke up at 9 to go to breakfast. And still, we were so exhausted from the night before. You know, but we all managed to obviously get pumped up for the game. And going into it, the legs weren't quite there. A little bit of a heat exhaustion for a lot of guys. And but we played hard and we battled hard. And boy, when that goal went in, that last goal was like slow motion, was off the faceoff. It was almost like slow motion, and we just, you know, our heads went down and had no emotion left in me. I mean, it was just a feeling of numbness, and we all got in the locker room, and it was just it was dead silent, a lot of tears. It was a long season, and it was a lot of fun and a lot of elation. And by no way that we didn't win it, you know, it wasn't a disappointing year for us. I mean, yeah, it took some time to get over, but now we have a lot of fond memories about that year, and especially about that game.
After your Gopher career now, you're still involved in hockey a little bit. You coach at Wayzata High School, and I guess full-time-wise, you're with the Frauen Shoe Companies in commercial real estate, but probably the exciting thing right now is coaching Wayzata, especially you're in the playoffs now.
Definitely. Fortunate enough to have a boss that let me combine the two, because hockey still runs through my blood. As you know, it's kind of an addiction for a lot of people, and it's a great stress relief for me to be able to coach hockey. I get a lot of enjoyment out of it, and it is very exciting. It's fun to work with kids and share back some of the knowledge that was given to me by some great people. And yeah, we're going through playoffs now, which and you know what it's like this when it gets into March in this area, the state just kind of stops dead, and everyone's watching the hockey, and we're looking forward to it, and we're getting excited.
Well, good luck, and thanks for stopping by.
Thank you.
All right, that's Dean Williamson, and obviously comes from a great hockey family. His dad, Murray Williamson, played for the Gophers, and Dean had a great Gopher career also. Let's send it back over to Frank and Doug.
All right, Doug, thank you very much. If I were to describe Dino, I mean, there's lots of ways to describe him. He's like the consummate small guy that brings heart and soul to your team.
Yeah,
none better.
He's great. He's on our Hall of Fame team, too, of the walk-ons.
The walk-on Wall of Fame.
Yeah. His dad played here, was an All-American, coach Olympic team, and Dino has that fire. He was just a great competitor here while he played. He kind of has that Roone and Gold blood, too, that's special.
Yeah.
And so we think the world of him. He's doing a great job over at Wayzata coaching. He wants to be a coach. I try to talk him out of it. He worked for Frauen Shoe as well. But he's a great young guy.
Did you give him, like, coaching pointers when he was playing here, or did he just absorb the game? Is he that kind of a guy?
I think he's a student, and he picked up the things we were doing. There's a lot of them at Wayzata. He's progressive. He's a real positive, and he's got Marty Nanny over there. He's got Jake Ennenbach. He's got the whole Gopher crew over there helping at Wayzata. But he's a learned kid.
Well, this year's inspiration in the form of a Dean Williamson comes from Dan Woog, and right now he is our player feature for tonight.
When I see him here at the rink, and you know, it's when I come here, it's business. You know, it's practice, and it's a job for us as well as him. Spend a lot of time here, and you know, when it comes down to it, that's what it is. I see him at practice. He's my coach. He's not my dad at practice. He's my coach, and that works out pretty well. he's put in a lot of time, you know, to get where he's at. So, I mean, nothing's come too easy for us. You know, we're a small town in South St. Paul. It's kind of a hardworking community, I'd say. And you know, I really respect the way he does things and how he's come about. He's went to Southwest High School, I think, for a while. Coached with the Vulcans, went to South St. Paul before he got to this level. So he's had a long road to follow also.
Brink now to the line. Wosley, treble. There's it, deflected by Wu, gonna go!
I mean, I haven't changed my work ethic. It's always been there, I think. And it's just getting a couple bounces, pucks coming on your stick instead of going the other way from the rebounds. And I mean, you have to be in the right places.
Out to center, picked off by Wu. Relay to head to Feeble.
I never thought it really happened that way. I mean, it was so dramatic. And then coming overtime against Duluth, and, you know, it's the biggest goal of my life.
Danny Wold, 3-2 Minnesota.
It was a big relief. It was, you know, big load come off my chest and off my back. You know, I knew I'd been playing, you know, well enough, but I, you know, hadn't contributed as much as I'd like to the team. And, you know, when you can get a couple goals or assists, it helps you feel that you've contributed more, and it makes you feel good about yourself.
Well, if Dan Wu keeps scoring goals the way he's been scoring them, he's going to make that walk-on Wall of Fame.
Yeah, well, 3 weeks don't make you a Hall of Famer, but it's been pretty good for him. He's had a, you know, real rise in points and contributed greatly to our team, so we're happy about that, and I'm sure he's the most excited of all.
How hard is he to coach?
Oh, he's great because he doesn't say anything. He's he just goes over the boards and plays, and he's sharp. I mean, Danny's assets are his hands and his head and his enthusiasm. So, you know, if he were a little bit bigger, he'd even be better. But we're real proud of him, and I think the guys are real happy he's contributing.
Okay, and also the fans enjoy watching him play. There's no doubt about that. The Doug Wu Show will continue in a moment. We'll do a final stage set for the Wisconsin series right after this timeout on Midwest Sports Channel. On Midwest Sports Channel, the Olympics on everybody's hockey minds these days, very much so. So is the name of Darby Hendrickson on everybody's lips. Is he headed to the U for the rest of the year?
Well, we don't know for sure. We certainly would entertain that thought. We'll get him back, hopefully, before hockey camp. We got our new camp up at Giants Ridge. We'll have him there for sure. But, yeah, we'd like to get him back, and, you know, if it works for him, we'll do it. So we got to wait and see what his reaction is.
Give me some betting odds, 50-50.
Oh, we can't bet. It's an NCAA, okay. NCAA violation.
You say
so.
Bet, just give me the odds.
Odds? I'd say 50-50.
Okay.
That doesn't answer a whole lot.
It doesn't, but it's a number.
That's right.
You mentioned your camp. Are you moving to a new location this year?
Yeah, we used to be up at Quadnipi. We're going to go to Giants Ridge, the ski deal in Bowavik, and we're excited about that. Our whole family's involved in that, so we'd like to have any young Gophers out there come to our camp. So, enough said.
Darby, too?
Darby will be working, yeah.
Really?
Yeah, a lot of the kids, almost all the players, Treville and Dustin and Bonin and Bergliot and Moen, I mean, all the, I shouldn't say Moen, Callan, they all get up there for a couple of weeks. So it's a fun experience. It's more than just a hockey camp. It's fishing and swimming and doing a lot of things.
Maybe later in the year we should talk a little bit about it at greater length, but we need to talk about the Badgers right now. You're in the locker room, you're giving your pep talk, easy to get them fired up. You like playing there because you got a winning record there, I think.
I would think so. And they'll have the trombones over the glass. I can see them going by, you know. Billy Butters got hit in the head one time. He said going by, they slipped the big thing out, the sleeve out. But it's a fun place to play, and they know they got the momentum going right now, and they got all their players healthy. We're a little hurt in that regard, but we've never played poorly in there, knock on wood. We've always come in and competed. Last year, we stole a point late in the game. Peeblecorn picked one up, and then we beat them the next night. So, we think we can win, and you know, it's always a challenge to go in there. It's obviously never easy, but it's always fun, and it has the real atmosphere of a collegiate game.
Yeah.
I mean, it has the spirit. When the Badgers and Gophers go together, it's always great, and I think both teams would admit that that's the biggest rivalry of the year.
They tend to be, at least their fans like to talk about them being a playoff team. Do you sense that as a coach? Are they a tougher team at the end of the year than they are during the season?
Well, you got to remember, they've had some pretty good talent, so they should be good at both ends. And you know, we've had our successes. What happens if you can win the national championship, that tends to overlook a lot of other things that are going on. It's just like Notre Dame. Everything's in a great athletic program. Well, you take away football, and what else is there? So if you win a couple big ones, that becomes the big issue. But I do think that we fare very well in playoffs against them, and we have a winning record in that. In late in the season, we have, and in their own building. So we shouldn't hide ourselves and be embarrassed about our record when it matches up against the Badgers in any way. So we've got to go in there and play and hope we come out. We need two wins, you know, to stay alive in the race, and that's the biggest thing.
Okay, and that will be coming your way on Midwest Sports Channel in just a couple of moments. Face off both Friday and Saturday night from the Dane County Memorial Coliseum. For Doug Woog, I'm Frank Mazzocco. We'll see you next week.